broken every chain and every curse off of their lives and freed them by the blood of Jesus Christ. Thank you, God, that they are yours. God, I pray that you take that and give us the Holy Spirit, finishing the task of taking the name of Jesus to every person on this planet so that the King and the Son of God can return to this earth and take us to our rightful place. God, we commend our lives to you until the nation come and worship.
Between us, now high the mountain, I could not climb.
I want to ask him if he will lead us now, places of truth, where we stop pretending and we honestly come before the living God. And we don't drive by, but we park and we bow down at the foot of the cross of Christ.
Wounded for our transgressions, he was bruised for our iniquity. Chastisement that brought us peace.
Father, thank you so much for this Sunday where we celebrate what you've done for us through Jesus, through your sacrifice and through your resurrection, Lord. And we do want to celebrate and worship you and give you all the praise and glory that we deserve. Thank you so much, Jesus. Amen. many times in our lives that you showed up. And we want to acknowledge the times that we don't even understand what you were doing. But still worship you, still we praise you, and we are thankful, knowing that you are good. And you have good plans for us. And there's so much that.
Thank you, worship team. All right. The title of this week's sermon is The Resurrection is Everything in 1 Corinthians 15. Yeah, I was, I was really excited about this sermon. And you know, there's not every time you feel like the devil's doing this or that, right? But I really feel like he doesn't want this message to be heard for some of you. So I don't know, that's just my feeling. All right, so we're talking about the resurrection. So in October 30th, 2016, researchers have continued their investigation to the site where the body of Jesus Christ is traditionally believed to have been buried, and their preliminary findings appear to confirm the portions of the tomb are still present today, having survived centuries of damage, destruction, and reconstruction of the surrounding church and the holy sepulchre in Jerusalem's old city. So, obviously that's not true, but you see, that's what was posted on a lot of of media channels, that they believe to have found the tomb where Jesus was buried. They have Yeshua here, and they have this person that's Mary, some form of Mary, Marianne, more some form of Mary, and some others. And it's interesting because they're looking for, I feel like they're looking for something instead of looking at the contextual understanding of that Yeshua was of the boys that were born in Jesus' time. About 40% were named Yeshua. So, and Mary, around 40% of people were named Mary. And also in that culture, it wasn't just husbands that were buried with their wives. There was brothers and sisters were buried next to each other too. So all of these cultural things that we're just thrown out the window and say, oh yeah, I just found this tomb. It says Yeshua and Mary around there, and therefore Jesus actually died, and he actually was married to Mary. And they actually made a movie on it. I don't know if you heard of this movie called The Da Vinci Code, right? Where Tom Hanks and Ron Howard take you through a rabbit hole, ending with the fact that Jesus married Mary Magdalene, and the Catholic Church hid this story and were seeking to kill the baby and any of the descendants so that all this truth wouldn't be known. I don't think it was based on what they actually believe, a group of people. So it's kind of troubling, but it kind of speaks to the fact that the resurrection of Jesus is something that people don't take for granted. It's something that's unusual. It's hard to believe, and so we're gonna walk through that essential truth in our belief that Jesus Christ resurrected from the dead, and why people want to discredit that fact. And if you want to discredit Christianity, you don't discredit that Jesus was actually a good person. You discredit that he resurrected from the dead. That's why they attack that. All right, so let's go to the first section of scripture on 1 Corinthians 15. I think space bar is usually sometimes, or maybe the arrow. There you go. Thank you. All right. Let's read the first part. Moreover, brethren, I declare to you the gospel which I preached to you, which you also received and which you stand, by which you are saved, if you hold fast that word which I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. For I delivered to you, first of all, that which I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and he was buried, and he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures, and that he was seen by Cephas, then by the 12. After that, he was seen by over 500 brethren at once, of whom the greater part remain to the present, but some have fallen asleep. After that, he was seen by James, and then by all the apostles. Then last of all, he was seen by me also, as by one born out of due time. For I am the least of the apostles, who am not worthy to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace toward me was not in vain, but I labored more abundantly than they all. Yet not I, but the grace of God which was with me. Therefore, whether it was I or they, so we preached, and so you believed. So he's taking you through the having them remember the original gospel, which when he first had a lot of people that were confusing the facts, but the original gospel that he was preaching them was that Jesus Christ died for their sins and he was resurrected. And then he was seen by Cephas. You've seen a couple different people who say, and then he was seen by over 500 people. Josephus, he's not a Christian, but he's a Jewish historian, collaborates that he was seen by these people after he was dead and rose again. And then he was seen by James and all the apostles. And then Paul is saying he's also seen by him out in on the road to Damascus. He saw Jesus, and that was part of his calling and his journey. So the first point that we want to bring about is, go to the next slide, is that the resurrection of Jesus is the good news. Without it, there is no good news. Why is there no good news? Because that means we still die in our sins. If Jesus did not resurrect from the dead, then he did not have the power to forgive our sins. And we're still under the punishment and the effect of sin, which is death. So what good news is there? There was a good person, and he healed some people. He said, love your neighbor. And he caused a bit of commotion, and he died. So great, let's follow his. That's not good news. I think there's, you can look to other great people, Gandhi, you can look to people that have contributed a lot to society and said good things. But the good news is that he overcame death. He overcame the effect of sin in our lives, which is death. And he showed that that we are going to resurrect from the dead as well. That's the good news. So he talks about, I think one of the things one of the classes I want to do eventually is proving the existence of God through logic. But the second one is how do you defend your Christianity? How did, especially the resurrection of Jesus? And so I took some few points out. If we go to the next slide. So the four undeniable facts. So if you're doing an investigation for yourself, and this one person that wrote this book called Cold Case Christianity, he was ex criminal detective. So he kind of looked through, and it kind of helped me come up with these facts that people can't deny. These are historical. Number one, Jesus Christ died on a cross and was buried. It's undeniable that there was actually a person named Jesus Christ. He actually was sentenced by Pontius Pilate to die, and he died on the cross and was buried. So we don't have Instagram of it, but there was people that were documenting history that multiple sources, right, besides just the Bible. Number two, Jesus' tomb was empty and no one ever produced his body. So yes, no one ever produced the body of Jesus. There is no body of Jesus Christ. I think if there was, people, that would be the easiest thing in the first century to do to discredit Jesus Christ, is produce the body of Jesus. Hey, it's crucified. He has, you know, I think it's not like, it's not like, this is Mississippi, you know, Mississippi, like people kill other people and then they throw them in the swamp and they can't find them forever, right? So you don't go to Mississippi, but that's what happens in Mississippi sometimes in the past. But Jerusalem, there's, in that time, there was no place that you could hide a body, right? It smelled, they just didn't have that kind of landscape, and also they just didn't do that back then. The body itself was even if they were crucified, they gave them the proper burial rites. They just didn't do that where they would hide a body or bury it somewhere people couldn't find it. So number three, Jesus' disciples believed that they saw Jesus resurrected from the dead. Now, I just talked to you about Josephus, but these were people that gave eyewitness testimony, and that was their biggest part of their testimony, is that I just saw somebody who saw somebody who saw somebody who somebody's uncle that saw Jesus resurrect the body, but they actually directly saw him. They directly saw his body. He had Thomas touch his hands, see the hole marks. There's what's called in when you're in a criminal case, there's what's called circumstantial evidence, where you see, okay, something happened. You see like a knife. You see broken walls. That's actually called circumstantial evidence. Direct evidence, the only form of direct evidence, is eyewitness testimony. So number four, Jesus' disciples were transformed following their alleged resurrection observations. So these people died with this belief, right? So one of the things that on the cold case Christianity, what they talk about, is if there's a lie, eventually it's found out. Even today, we find out murders like 50, 60 years after the fact, right? If there is a lie, eventually it's found out. And the more time that goes by, the story dissipates, and that's why you can unravel it. And there's people, eventually there's one person or two people that are weak links that say, oh, that we were participating in that lie. You know, even today, I don't know, have you seen, like, people think everything's a secret, then somebody writes a book like 50 years later and tells about all the things that they did, right? There's nothing that's secret for long. So, and Jesus' disciples were transformed, like, as a result of that, you know. They were depressed that Jesus died, and they were like, oh my goodness, what's going to happen to us? Our leader's gone. We don't know what to do. And then they saw his resurrected body, and it transformed their lives as a result. They're like, it doesn't matter. We're going to be resurrected too. You know, it's not just death that we're worrying about. So that's four undeniable facts that you can say to yourself or others when they're saying that Jesus Christ did not rise from the dead. All right, let's go to the next piece of scripture. So I broke this down into two pages here. Now, if Christ has preached that he has been raised from the dead, how do some among you say that there is no resurrection from the dead? But if there is no resurrection from the dead, then Christ is not risen. And if Christ is not risen, then our preaching is empty and your faith is also empty. Yes, we And we are found false witnesses of God, because we have testified of God that he raised up Christ, whom he did not raise up, if in fact the dead do not rise. If the dead do not rise, and then Christ is not risen. If Christ has not risen, your faith is futile, and you are still in your sins. Then also those who have fallen asleep in Christ have perished. If in this life we only have Christ, we of all men are the most pitiable. So he's giving a series of logic, because the Corinthians, some of them actually believed in the resurrection of Jesus, but they didn't believe that they would be resurrected. So because of that, they were believing that they had to improve the existing body that they were, have the most of, one life to live it, right? Because they aren't going to be resurrected. So the problem with the Corinthians is that they already assumed that their heavenly assistant, that was to be an existence in the spirit, that this counted earthly existence both in physical and behavioral expressions, meaning that they believed that it was this weird belief that after they became Christians, they believed that their existence is self-changed. And so that is the only thing that they could improve upon. And therefore, they're like, well, if we attain more gifts, we're becoming more of our heavenly body that we were supposed to be in the future. But Jesus is saying, no, you're going to go through death, and then you're going to be resurrected, and then you'll have a new body. So that's what Paul is saying, that it was their mistaken belief. So let's go to the next set of scriptures. And then, again, the logical argument is, if we're preaching a lie and we're dying over a lie, man, you should have pity on us, meaning like what we're doing is for nothing, right? If we're dying, they were getting their possessions taken away, and Paul suffered many things, and death, and people, and separation from family members. And if they're all doing that for a lie, it would be worthless, right? So let's continue. But now Christ is risen from the dead and has become the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. For since by man came death, by man also came the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, even so in Christ all shall be made alive, but each one in his own order. Christ the first fruits, afterward those who are Christ at his coming. Then comes the end, and he delivers the kingdom of God the Father, when he puts an end to all rules and all authority and power, for he must reign till he has put all enemies under his feet. The last enemy that will be destroyed is death, for he has put all things under his feet. But when he says all things are put under him, it is evident that he who puts all things under him is accepted. Now, when all things are made subject to him, then the Son himself will also be subject to him who put all things under him, that God may be all in all. Let's go through this a little bit. This is there's a heavy theology in here. So the first word that is emphasized is first fruits. So it's kind of like, who is your leader? So Adam, who is our leader in our human race, right? He was the first person to die and suffer the effects of sin. And so we kind of follow him. He's our leader in that we follow death as a result of our sins. But Jesus is the first person in another leadership kind of category, in that he was the first to rise from the dead. And therefore, if we're Christians and we've been born again, we will rise from the dead, just like Jesus rise from the dead. So that kind of first fruit is there's actually a feast of first fruits in in the Jewish culture, which points to this happening. So the next thing is that he has put all the enemies under his feet. So Jesus, obviously there's Satan, there's demons, there's everybody that's against him, right? But the last enemy that he conquered, that he put under his feet, meaning he conquered them, is death. So that's part of the gospel. So let's go to point two. Is the resurrection of Jesus is the proof that we will resurrect from the dead. So the resurrection of Jesus is the proof that we will resurrect from the dead. So everybody, in fact, will be resurrected in some way, shape, or form, right? So we just talked about our spirit, even after death. There's an existence. So you have an existence to judgment, to eternal life away apart from God, which was your decision you made on earth, right? Or eternal life with God, in the presence of God, which is, if you're born again, that's your heart desire to be eternally with God. Christians, however, do not just continue to live, but they have a resurrected body. And these spiritual bodies that we have, that we will have, it will look similar to Christ's resurrected body. So that's something that, in addition to us living forever, which everybody lives forever, but we have this new resurrected body, similar to Christ, that we inherit because of Christ. Number two, it shows that Christ has the power to redeem our bodies themselves from the consequences of sin, which is death. So the point that we can bring from this is, if Jesus resurrected from the dead, he has the power to heal today. He's still alive, right? He has the power to redeem our lives, even though we have problems as a result of our mistakes. So him resurrecting from the dead proves that he still has that power today. If he didn't, then we couldn't expect him, a dead person, to be able to make any impact on our lives. So let's go to the last part of this scripture. This is kind of long. I think I missed a piece of this. I'm going to read a piece of this that was not here. Otherwise, what will they do who are baptized for the dead, or if the dead do not rise at all? Why then are they baptized for the dead? And why do we stand in jeopardy every hour? I affirm by the boasting in which I have in Jesus our Lord, I die daily. If in the manner of men I have fought with the beast of Ephesus, at what advantage is to me? If the dead do not rise, let us eat and drink, for tomorrow we die. Do not be deceived. Evil company corrupts good habits. Awake to righteousness and do not sin. For some do not have the knowledge of God. I speak this to your shame. So he talks about also at that time, I don't know if you know, but as the Roman emperors, as for fun, they didn't have UFC back then, right? They had gladiators that were fighting to the death, and part of these matches were Christians, and they would put like riled like lions and tigers, and they would watch them like kill the Christians, right? So he's saying, so if there is no resurrection from the dead, they're dying uselessly, right? And so, and there is another piece that he talks about is that don't be deceived. Evil company corrupts good habits. And I'm going to put that in there. And that, so be careful, he's saying, to the company that you keep, because they could destroy the good habits that you've already established, which is he's talking to belief in the resurrection from the dead, right? But someone will say, now we continue what's on here. How are the dead raised? And with what body do they come? Foolish one, what you sow is not made alive unless it dies. And what you sow, you do not sow that body that shall be, but mere grain, perhaps wheat or some other grain. But God gives it a body as he pleases, and to each seed its own body. Here, he's giving a metaphor with a seed, and then out of a seed, I wrote, the spirit, the life-giving spirit, transforms what is flesh and blood and makes it fit for heaven. So he's given additional details about the, you know, kind of the flesh is kind of the seed that God has given us, but part of it growing to what it was destined for is the transformation, and that transformation is that the Holy Spirit does in our regular body to make it the body that we were destined for. All right. There are also celestial bodies and terrestrial bodies, but the glory of the celestial is one, and the glory of the terrestrial is another. There is one glory of the sun, another glory of the moon, and another glory of the stars, for one differs from another star in glory. So this is he's saying that if you look at, even at that time, they didn't have telescopes, right? But they could look, and they weren't very astute astronomers in some ways, but they could look at the stars. There's planets, stars, and different suns. And he's saying that there is a different, he's describing the different mass in the planet of stars that produce different brightness to the eye, right? So he's giving an example that we will have a different brightness that of our body, that of our resurrected body, that we're going to achieve once we die. All right, continuing on. So is the resurrection from the dead. The body is sown in corruption, it is raised in incorruption. It is sown in dishonor, it is raised in glory. It is sown in weakness, it is raised in power. It is sown as a natural body, it is raised a spiritual body. There is a natural body and there is a spiritual body. And so is written, the first man became a living being, the last man became a life-giving spirit. Here he's describing that born again gives us a new spiritual body that lasts forever. So let's continue. It's a long piece of the passage here. However, the spiritual is not first, but the natural, and afterward the spiritual. The first man was of earth, made of dust, and the second man is the Lord of heaven. As was the man of dust, so also are those who are made of dust. And as in the heavenly man, so also are those who are heavenly. And as we have borne the image of man in dust, we shall also bear the image of the heavenly man. He's talking here about a man who was made from dust, and he's going back to dust, right? Eventually, our body decays because of entropy, and eventually our bodies become the dust of what we were created. But when we're born again, what we're born from did not come from dirt. It came from the Spirit of God, and therefore it continues to be from the Spirit of God, this celestial life since we came from the heavens, we're going to come back to the heavens. All right, so let's go to the second part here. All right. We're almost done. Now I say to this, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does corruption inherit incorruption. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not sleep, but we shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For the corruptible must put on incorruption, and the mortal must put on immortality. So when the corruptible has put on incorruption, and the mortal has put on immortality, then shall we be brought past the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. And he's going into Isaiah 25:8 here. O death, where is your sting? O Hades, where is your victory? The sting of death is sin. The strength of the sin is the law. But thanks be to God who gives us victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my brethren, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. So the trumpet that he's talking about is the trumpet in Revelation, right? So at the end, there's trumpets being sounded. The last trumpet before the eternal reign of Christ, that last trumpet declares everything is over, right? And that, and he's saying that before, for that trumpet to sound, before that, that we're going to gain our resurrected bodies, right? We're going to be made perfect. We are corruptible, meaning your propensity to sin, right? We all have this. We try our best to fight against a sinful nature and fight against being corrupted, but you know, we just have the propensity to be corrupted. The Romans had this saying, like power corrupts, absolute power corrupts absolutely. Talking about, you know, why a lot of the Caesars, emperors came to be that way. All right. So the third point is, in our battle against sin, we look forward to the return of Christ to attain a body that is not capable of sinning anymore. Again, in our battle against sin, we look forward to the return of Christ to attain a body that is not capable of sinning anymore. Jesus didn't come so that we could, that the main reason that he came is not that we could be freed from our oppression of free from not working, free from going through different circumstances. The reason that he came is, number one, to forgive our sins. That's our main problem. And then after we become a Christian, our main problem is fighting the sinful nature that we have. Embracing the Holy Spirit, embracing God instead of embracing what our sinful nature is telling us to do. So what's the point? So number one, the first point is, we need to have a ready defense against those who say that Christ did not rise from the dead. That's why I gave you those four points. There's going to be not only media, but there's going to be other religions that are presented to you, especially in college. Most colleges are very liberal. So you're going to have in your head that Jesus Christ rose from the dead, and you have to have reasons why. Because you, just like this article that's written, just because it's in CNN or just because you read it in a professor is saying it in a class or a different religion is explaining how that didn't really happen because of this, and they actually found his body here, and you know, if you come across that, you need to have a ready defense to know that Jesus Christ rose from the dead. That's because that's the essentials of Christianity. Number two, we can trust that Jesus can overcome any situation in our life that seems hopeless because he resurrected from the dead. So if it's not hopeless, you know, we don't need Jesus, right? I mean, if I have the ability to solve my problem myself, right? Why don't, you know, and you know, like it's those hopeless situations that that where everything seems dead. There's no meaning. There's no, when people look at you or what you're going through, they're like, there's nothing you can do. Just accept it, right? So if in those situations, I would say death is probably the final situation that where you can do nothing about it, right? You're dead. It's over. You know, no matter how rich you were, you know, no matter what you accomplish, it's over, right? But Jesus has the power to overcome death, the place where absolutely nothing can be done. So there isn't any situation that's too hopeless that Jesus cannot overcome as a result, logically. Number three, instead of concentrating on Jesus relieving our stress, anxiety, and pain, when he resolves our sin problem, we can truly change. Just let me read that again. Instead of concentrating on Jesus relieving our stress, anxiety, and pain, when he solves our sin problem, we can truly change. You might not believe that. you might say, no. If I resolve my stress, anxiety, and pain, then I can change. I can become the person. Then I'll be happy. Then I'll become the person that I want to be. But Jesus is saying, you resolve your sin problem, and then we can truly change. I've done some study on this. I want to talk to showing this in practical reality. And what I've seen, get my master's in counseling really troubled individuals in the foster care system, in the Department of Corrections, in psychiatric facilities. So let's go to the next slide. I want to just give an example. So we learn a lot in psychology from neuroscience, and that, you know, they're doing like MRIs into your brain, right? To and that's how we develop drugs like dopamine and for depression. So that's a healthy brain over there. You see all the activity when you don't have depression, right? There's a lot of activity. There's a frontal lobe, and there's the back of the brain. You can see that there's all kinds of activity there. And in depression, you can see that all that activity is absent, right? Right. So the Bible talks about a root of bitterness. And it's kind of, you know, there's Alzheimer's and there's dementia, and that looks completely different. There's actually the brain muscle tissues itself, they die, right? So you actually have less brain matter. But this is, we have intact brain matter, but they're just the pathways, there's like synapses that are firing, and these synapses aren't firing, right? And so the Bible talks about the root of bitterness being, and what I've found is anger and anxiety are very similar, except there's just not a lot, people don't do a lot of neurological studies on this. A lot for me, those emotions are very similar in terms of brain activity, in terms of what people are actually feeling emotionally. So what I found is that especially when you have bitterness, and when you have hopelessness, these brain patterns start start happening in your brain. You start thinking these thoughts like, it's hopeless. I'm not good enough. There's nothing I can do. I should have done this. So one of the effective treatments for depression is not only with antidepressants, but it's also cognitive behavioral therapy. You replace those negative thoughts with positive thoughts. No, it's not over. I'm not worthless. And it helps. So what Jesus does, and Jesus is the human form of the Word of God, right? So what he does, I believe, is these pathways, these roots of bitterness that are happening in your brain, what he does is and they're dead in some way. So what he does is he enacts those parts of our brain. And so he's, as a result of dealing with that bitterness, that hopelessness, that deadness, right? And the reason that people have studied this, and they studied, hey, if you do, here's your frontal lobes. This is your baseline. This is a normal brain. They're not looking at a depressed brain, right? And then when a person is doing meditation, and this is religious meditation, it's not just meditation, but the study was based on religious meditation. There's more activity in the brain, actually, right? And it speaks to, yes, all meditation is good, but I believe that from what I've seen, even with cognitive behavioral therapy, if it isn't the Word of God, it's only temporary. Those bad thoughts and these pathways just get reenacted again. So where am I going with this? What I'm going with this is that do your quiet time. It's not just a religious activity. It's actually something that is changing your biological chemistry. And then on top of that, the deadness that is happening as a result. I mean, it's great if you have a really stress-free life and you're rich and you have everything that you wanted. Maybe you don't ever go through depression, anxiety, and anger, right? But you're gonna have that happen to you someday. You're gonna have circumstances happen to you, and then your brain activity is gonna start to be impacted. And what I've found is the Word of God, is Jesus Christ's resurrection power. Is the only thing that I've seen that's able to overcome long-term hopelessness, depression, anxiety. I've struggled with it as well, and even doing the own counseling myself, the only thing that I've found is that Jesus Christ. And on top of that, what I've found is his methodology of transforming you and transforming these dead pathways is forgiveness. When I feel that God has forgiven me of my sins, it's because they accumulate. And when he forgives me of my sins, then I'm able to enjoy the life that he's given me. My thought patterns change, and my life becomes happier as a result. Yeah. All right. What I wanted to, before we go, I think there's one last point. Okay, I guess let's just let the Word of God speak this. Let's spend just a few moments in prayer and just think through and meditate on what the resurrection power of Jesus Christ means. And what's behind our pain, what's behind our anxiety, depression? Is it just our circumstances? But look through and ask God for forgiveness. When a person that couldn't walk came to Jesus, Jesus' first response was, "You are forgiven." That was his main need. And that could transform his life. Let's focus on and spend some time in repentance, spend some time asking God to forgive us of what we can't forgive ourselves. The world tells us, just forgive yourself. Forgive yourself from that pain. But we know that we don't have that power. We try, and we cannot get rid of the pain and the of sin that others have caused to us, and the pain of our own sins, our own mistakes. Let's ask God to forgive us, and to cleanse us, and to create this new person that He's already has within us, to have it shine brighter. Lord Jesus, we thank you for this time. We know that you're the only answer. Your resurrection is undeniable. And there is no situation externally that's too hopeless. But internally, the conflict that we have in our heart and in our mind and in our feelings, all of these aren't hopeless. The world tells us just to cope. But we believe that forgiveness of our sins can transform us, transform what the world cannot do. And we can experience new pathways of hope and joy, regardless of what our circumstances and our past has done to us. We thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. We can go straight into the discussion questions. So you can go to the discussion questions. I'll just count 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1. So all the ones go with Thomas and twos go with Mr. Kang. Thank you.
decisions that are as big as you are, God, that in no way their lives would ever from this moment be good to you in any way. They would represent and say, we are the people of God.